Welcome back, everyone, to theCUBE's coverage of the HIMSS Show 2025 here at the Venetian in Las Vegas. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, and we are here with Google and many of its ecosystem partners talking about the future of healthcare innovation. With that, I've got two great guests for this next segment. I'd like to welcome back Shweta Maniar. She is the Global Director, Healthcare and Life Sciences at Google Cloud. Thank you so much, Shweta.
Thank you for having me.
And Tom Hittinger, he is the Senior Manager, Product and Applied AI at Deloitte Consulting. Thank you so much for coming on theCUBE.
It's great to be here, Rebecca.
So you two go way back. You have worked together for many years. In fact, your working relationship predates Gen AI, which who can even remember that now?
That's right.
So why don't you start by sort of level setting where we are right now? I mean, we know there is massive investment in AI across many industries, especially healthcare and life sciences. Deployment has still been a challenge. Where are we right now, Tom?
Yeah. Well, Shweta and I, several years ago, initially we were working together to think about how do you make technology more useful in healthcare and life sciences, right? I think the impressive part about Google's entire stack is it's always been really differentiated and advanced. But it's different when you're talking to a client and a customer about an API versus a vision.
Right.
You know? And I think the underlying technology, I know Google's been working on it since 2018, just the transformer architecture, generative AI, pioneering that. But I think what's really, really interesting is that inflection point in late 2022, and now in 2025, right, with AI and agentic AI, of making technology more useful and more usable, if you'd agree. And I think the conversation has fundamentally always been around what are the problems that customers are trying to solve? What are the areas of greatest cost, greatest pain? What are the ways in which they can best serve their customers? And now it's been, what are the new tools in the toolkit and the new things that we can use in the arsenal to make it kind of create value?
So what, in your estimation, is holding organizations back from that? I mean, what are the problems, so what's keeping them from doing it?
Well, I'd say two things are true. One, people are getting a lot of value already from AI, and two, there's more value to be kind of gained. And that's where I think, kind of on point number one, what, you know, I know we've both seen in the market since we've been working together pre-generative AI is healthcare and life sciences organizations have now started scaling AI. And so over 75% of them say it's met or exceeded their ROI goals. They've gotten return on investment building with AI, deploying that to their employees, to their clinicians, to their partners, to their customers. I think the challenge, though, has been how do you scale it? So that's where a lot are doing it, a lot are experimenting and seeing value, but actually a small minority, you know, between kind of depending which industry subsector, 10 to 25% are actually scaling fully into production and thinking, we are enterprise ready in AI. And so I think that's kind of what's interesting here.
And I was going to say, that's actually one of the big, there's two things I wanted to add. One is the big kicker is the ones who are realizing value are the ones who are not thinking about it from a point solution, but they are thinking about it across their entire enterprise, like a true digital transformation. The other piece I would also say to your original question to Tom was, you know, what is stopping these, or what, you know, why is there not the progress that we'd like to see? I think now we're coming to a point where now we're having the boards and the leaders of these organizations not just wanting to experiment with these tools and AI, but it's now becoming a fundamental foundation of their strategy moving forward. So there's no such thing as a tech company or an AI company. It's more around, you know, everybody is a tech company, an AI company in the way that they work, right?
Yeah. And what's interesting is that you have to ask the question, why aren't we getting more value?
Right.
And I think that comes down to how AI is being used today versus how it will be used tomorrow. The difference between AI versus agentic AI, which is the topic of our conversation here, right? And the kind of difference I think about is AI in the kind of first wave is more AI as an assistant. You prompt it, it responds. So it enables people to do things at kind of task A, task B, task C more effectively, more efficiently. But going from assistant to true collaborator is, I think, the real difference, is how do you leverage these new agentic AI platforms and tools to not just do a single task, but to actually transform an entire process. And our customers, that's what they're thinking about. It's not, hey, how do I do one specific action better? They're saying, hey, how do I serve my patients better? How do I actually provide better service to whether it be my health plan member, my patient? How do I get drugs to market faster? How do I better identify the next candidate? And that's that's not a task problem, that's a process problem.
Right.
It's, you know, end-to-end, hundreds and hundreds of tasks. I think being able to manage that is where we're really going to start getting value, which is where these agentic kind of tools come into play.
Well, in order for it to move from a tool and capability to a true partner and collaborator, as you say, that requires a lot of trust, and trust remains a huge hurdle. What is it going to take to build the confidence needed and the trust in patients and providers and regulators to use AI in this way?
I mean, it's a really, really important question. The first thing for me is you have to be able to understand what you're building and actually how to use it, which is why I think the latest, I mean, announcements in the past several weeks with agent space are really interesting, right? Agent space makes it easy to build agents, which are really, really hard to build. Because if you and I set out today and said, let's build an agent, we have to understand source system A, source system B, how they interact, how they exchange information, who needs permissions, what task needs to be performed. It's a lot of steps, and it gets very, very technical very, very quickly. So I think part of building trust is making it easy, not just for a really, really technical data scientist or AI engineer to do something, but for anyone who kind of has the functional expertise and the goal in mind, to be able to know, you know, how do I create an agent? How do I understand what the agent does? How do you make it easier for me to solve the core problem at hand? Which is not building an agent, that's a technology problem. The fundamental problem is how do I create the value for my customers and for my employees, for my clinicians, for my staff? So I think step one is making it usable so people can see it in action.
Yeah. So I want to talk more about agent space, but before we even get there, Shweta, why don't you set the scene for us, because we know that traditional AI has struggled with unstructured data and reasoning, but agentic AI promises to be a real game changer. Can you tell our viewers a little bit about how you see this future unfolding?
So with agentic AI is what you're referencing, right? So, you know, this is I think the core of what we'd like to talk about today, right? Which is around looking at how you can take structured data, unstructured data, imaging information, genomic information. This is now when you're starting to bring all of these different type of data types. And with some of the announcements that we've just made, right? Now you no longer have to take an image and convert it to text before it can actually be put in the system. Now that image can be put in directly where you're not losing some of the context when you're having to first convert it to text. Yeah. And so a lot of the capabilities, or I think what we are now going to be unlocking, is going to allow us to be able to massively change the way that we use agentic AI, because now you can look at a lot of different type of data sources and data types and ask some very, very unique questions that take multiple tasks and make it into something that's much more seamless than I think ever before.
Yeah.
So what are some of the most promising use cases that you've seen with agentic AI? Because as you point out, so much of healthcare data is, there are charts, there are photographs, there is numbers.
Absolutely.
A lot of it is
written.
Exactly, right.
Yeah. Well, I think the use case bingo game that we've been playing for the last few years, it's all about anchoring to what is the value we're going to create. So we know that the problems to solve in healthcare are bringing that next drug to market faster, better, cheaper. We know that within health insurance, it's being able to process claims, make decisions, and service members. We know among providers, it's being able to actually deliver high quality, excellent care in a way that drives health literacy for patients so that they can actually follow the treatment protocol and get the outcomes and live the healthiest life that they want to. And so what you do is you look at what are the problems we're solving, and therefore how do we start taking a piece out of that? So there are two things. Let's talk about what use cases have already gained traction, and let's talk about what can. So what already has gained traction, we know customer service. So being able to make it easier for people who are fundamentally fielding the phone calls to give answers. Health insurance is so complicated, only 5% can actually explain the basic terms, deductibles, out of pocket, pretty low percentage. But that's fundamentally why people are calling in to call centers, is I don't understand the product that I'm using, help me understand it better. And then going from there, it's really, how do you make the person on the other end of the phone able to answer their questions more easily? We're seeing a lot of traction there. Second is on the code generation. So people, enterprise architects, others who are actually building code, we've seen a rapid uptick in essentially being able to help autocomplete code for them and make them code faster. I'd say third, there's a lot around knowledge management. How do you search documents faster?
Absolutely.
Protocols, handbooks, guides, things that make nurses able to start their job more easily. And those are all things that have gotten faster, better, cheaper through AI. The last one I'd probably add that's true for pharma, biotech, as well as health insurance and provider, is marketing. Being able to create marketing campaigns faster, more effectively, using a series of tools in the kind of legacy marketer and marketing agency toolkit. So those things are all gaining traction, right?
Their commonality, I would add, is that any area or any problem or pocket where there's a lot of paperwork or administrative paperwork or, you know, toil,
yeah,
that's where we can find efficiencies and value to be had.
Yeah.
So removing the admin, removing the toil, as you say, is something that, that most people would want in their jobs, especially the physicians and the clinicians who are drowning in admin, spending hours of their day filling out forms and working with charts and electronic medical records. But what is the upshot? What is what is the real difference made in terms of how care is delivered and the way patients feel it on the other end?
I mean, I think it's making information more and insights more readily accessible. So right now, we know that doctors have to comb through medical records. They're kind of virtual filing cabinets in many ways. But being able to surface that information, search it more easily, and do it in a way where the doctor doesn't have to be doing clicking the button every time is really where I think the upshot comes. And the example that I like to give is, this is a perfect agentic AI use case, right? So we know that we can already build an AI solution that enables a doctor to perform clinical search and summarization. So they can see the summary of a patient's information and have a search bar where they ask about the last A1C measures for a patient, for instance. But that agentic experience kind of, and bear with me, Rebecca, as I kind of throw out some language that I think simplifies it but isn't used as much. Agentic AI is kind of the best parts of robotic process automation combined with generative AI. So we've all seen robotic process automation for a decade. It's automating something through predefined rules and a set of a kind of a process end to end. But now I think agentic AI is being able to reason, plan, and act end to end in a way that the doctor doesn't have to click the button every single time. And so that in a clinical search and summarization is a doctor being able to give a goal saying, hey, I actually want to understand what this patient has been diagnosed for over the last 10 years to be able to then inform my medical coders for submitting paperwork and claims, to be able to then also inform my care plan that I'm developing for a patient and have all those steps, those kind of 20 to 30 steps of them previously combing through every medical record, every chart, every image, every encounter, to be able to have that happen in the background with an agent that's following a goal to support our caregivers and our clinicians in a more effective way.
I was going to say, he also, I mean, he mentioned earlier, but Tom, also the other upshot is the patient side.
Yes, the most important.
Right, exactly. The other upside of this is the care that they receive, but it's also empowering them with information, right? Empowering them with the information so that they can be stewards of their own health. And I think part of that is to move away or kind of sift through all of this data and really trying to empower them with the information so that they can ask the questions that they want, have their preferences, and certainly at the future, personalize their care, right?
Yeah.
And have a more personalized interaction with their health system.
So Tom, AI has the potential to democratize healthcare access and accelerate scientific discovery in really exciting ways. What advancements do you see on the horizon and what is most thrilling to you?
Yeah, I think the notion of discovery could be so much better. So this is true in scientific discovery.
Yes.
When Shweta and I were thinking years ago about literature search, perfect use case. There's more information than information breakthroughs coming from the medical and scientific community than any one person if their full-time job is just to read all the new studies. They couldn't even keep up with it, right? So being able to make it easier to discover information, discover insights, and shape the care that, you know, an individual provider is giving to a patient, that has the potential to really just change the way in which we're driving patient outcomes, right? Not just giving something that was a legacy recommendation and evidence-based guidelines from 10 years ago, but something that's fresh, on the bleeding edge, that enables a patient to have information specific to them, their demographics, where they live, what medication they're taking, what, you know, procedures they've received. I think that is like one of the most bleeding horizons. In addition to just number two, opening up more access. So we know it's hard to see a doctor, you don't see them for that much time, and you don't get as much personalized information as you may like. And so being able to open up so that patients can do as much self-education and education with authoritative information before and after a visit, that helps them have a better, authentic conversation with their provider, I think is already happening with generative AI today.
Last question for both of you. Shweta, what would What would one piece of advice that you would give to a healthcare executive about AI adoption, what would it be?
So I think that's a fantastic question. And I always give everyone the same thing, and I'm making a chart here, a graph here in front of you, in front of myself here. And that is, if you look at what are your biggest business problems, what are the ones that are going to be, if you look at it from three ways, your biggest business problems, the risks, level of risk, and time to value. And if you look at those and identify what are the less risky, maybe quicker wins, they might not be as exciting, but you're able to show in a very controlled manner how it actually can apply, and then you start scaling scaling up from there. I think that's going to be, that's the biggest advice, because you've got these pie in the sky ideas, but sometimes the highest value opportunities might be the ones that might be perceived as not as exciting.
Yeah, Tom?
Yeah. And I think it's, to me, think about scaling now, not later.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
I have seen too many proofs of concept and even pilots reach a dead end for many reasons that could have been preempted much earlier in the process. One example is when it comes to being able to kind of create something like a after visit summary or a nurse handoff report, these things that are fundamentally about combing through clinical information and making it useful for a clinician, a frontline staff member, that fundamentally relies upon the data foundations. Your data has to be accurate, it has to be accessible, it has to be usable in the right standard and format. It gets out into the weeds really quickly, where you can easily make something work for 10 users, but making it work for 10,000 users really requires a lot of elbow grease and legwork to establish that data foundation, to establish that right provisioning, to establish the right security and infrastructure. And I think it's always time well spent investing in infrastructure for the sake of outcomes and for the sake of being able to build differentiated next generation AI applications.
Excellent. Don't wait to scale. Tom and Shweta, thank you both so much. A great conversation.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.
And thank you for tuning into this special segment of theCUBE's coverage of the HIMSS conference. I'm Rebecca Knight. Stay tuned for more. You're watching theCUBE.